Audible Inc. presents BlackBerry Planet, the story of research in motion and the little device that took the world by storm. Written by Alastair Sweeny. Narrated by Bill Quinn. Preface. Welcome to BlackBerry Planet. When I started to research this book and study research in motion, REM, I simply wanted to explore how a Greek-Canadian wireless geek and his Harvard MBA hockey jock sidekick invented, perfected, and took to market the world's most addictive device, the BlackBerry. Another typical high-tech success story, right? But as I dug deeper into the remarkable history of research in motion, I found there's a lot more to this tale than just a company romance, although on its own it is an extraordinary story. The birth of REM's BlackBerry and other mobile web devices like Apple's iPhone marks a major turning point in how we live and work. It also points the way toward a much more spectacular device that is now emerging, a tool I call the telebrain. It soon struck me that the world has suddenly changed course and is evolving in ways that seem like 1950s science fiction. As my old teacher Marsha McLuhan famously put it, the human race is starting to plug deeply into electric technology, and we are increasingly wearing our brains outside our skulls. But how did this change of course happen so fast? It's as if a light bulb switched on in a dark room. Suddenly, there is a huge tribe of 25 million people who simply cannot get along without REM's electronic organizer. The change started in the enterprise, and virtually all major corporations use BlackBerry servers. In a few short years, the BlackBerry has become the world's foremost mobile business tool and the planet's elite electronic communicator. The U.S. government alone runs over 500,000 BlackBerries, and some say that BlackBerries now run the U.S. government. But REM's success story also has a dark side. In the book, we explore the various court cases REM has faced, including the grueling 5-year legal grind that ended in a $650 million payout, the largest technology patent settlement in U.S. history. And we look at abusers of the BlackBerry, people trapped in an always-on world, whose personal and family lives are suffering from their dependence on this device. Big things often come in small packages, and radical new businesses can rise out of tiny startup companies. In 1984, the year Steve Jobs brought out his first Apple Macintosh, Research in Motion, REM, began life in Waterloo, Ontario, as a two-person tech startup in a one-room office. The founders were a 23-year-old college dropout named Mike Lazaridis and his boyhood friend, Doug Fregan. From the get-go, REM was a company with a difference. Mike and Doug were both practical and visionary at the same time, and the pair turned out to be superb engineers. Financed at the start by family funds and a $15,000 government loan, REM's first big job was a $600,000 contract, making networked LCD display screens for the General Motors Canada assembly line. 10 years later, Mike Lazaridis stood on stage at the Academy Awards and accepted an Oscar from actor Anne Hesch for REM's DigiSync film barcode reader, a device that revolutionized Hollywood. In the late 1980s, Research in Motion got in bed with AT&T, Rogers, and Ericsson, and started to build miniature radios and modems to let PCs send data and messages over mobile networks. In 1996, REM came up with the Interactive Pager 900, the world's first pocket-sized two-way pager. 2 years later, it built its first BlackBerry, the 950, a wireless wonder that synchronized with a user's desktop computer and corporate email. Since 1992, Mike Lazaridis and co-CEO Jim Balsillie have been the tandem team driving the REM story. BlackBerry Planet details their passion to build and deliver the foremost mobile business tool on the planet. Their BlackBerry has become a compulsory communicator, used by 85% of the Fortune 500 companies. The Queen has a BlackBerry and shares her email address with favored subjects. Today's politicians can't operate without it. U.S. President Barack Obama's struggles to keep his device in the White House gained him enormous sympathy. He's the first BlackBerry president. With input from REM veterans and competitors, BlackBerry Planet tells the story of the BlackBerry from its early days, starting with its use during the 9/11 attacks, which earned REM a reputation for security and reliability. Now the Swiss Army knife of smartphones, REM's super secure email device and web browser is becoming what the company calls a lifestyle platform, packed with applications and features that can do everything from online banking to opening your garage door. I wrote BlackBerry Planet as a business biography of research in motion, but I soon became drawn to the social side of BlackBerry use, the cultural adoption of this iconic device as a must-have status symbol, as well as the backlash against the addictive properties of what quickly became known as the CrackBerry. This little device is having a profound effect on daily life, family relations, and manners beyond the world of business. Most governments and businesses which use the BlackBerries get major productivity gains with the devices. Studies tell us that BlackBerry use can boost employee productivity by more than 30%. It's helped change the way we communicate in the enterprise, being always on, always connected. But at the same time, it is leading to major headaches for managers and employees. Digging deeper into BlackBerry Planet, I found that there is a serious downside to BlackBerry use. Lazaridis and Balsillie knew they had an addictive device right from the start, but they have always stressed the sunny side of device dependence. Balsillie calls it calming. It's true that BlackBerry addicted execs who use their device to excess may be more productive, but they can develop an addiction as strong as that experienced by alcoholics or chemical abusers. Email checking junkies who can't live without their BlackBerries can't laugh off the truth. They are addicts. So what makes BlackBerry users tick? If you're a BlackBerry outsider from another planet, you've seen these people. Hunched over their devices on the train or bus or subway, tip-tip-tapping with their thumbs, more productive than thou. Heads bowed in the meeting room, as if in prayer, fiddling over something under the table. Thumbing in their cars, looking as if they are pushing on the horn. When the light turns green, there is a furious beeping as cars honk to get the BlackBerry bozo's attention. Or you're out in a social setting. You're talking to someone and have her full attention. And then you hear a gentle buzz and suddenly her eyes glaze over. She pulls a BlackBerry out of her pocket, turns her head, and without saying sorry, she is gone, lost in the reply. Or you and your wife have just forked over a fortune to get tickets for Don Giovanni, and now you are in your seats, entranced by the majesty of the voices. Suddenly your eye is drawn to a little pool of light off to your left, and yes, there is a BlackBerry barbarian tapping on his infernal little device. The performance is ruined. If you're a citizen of BlackBerry Planet, however, you're lord of the ringtones. Entering the elevator, as the door closes, you pull out your precious device and check your urgent email, in sync with all the other passengers. You arrive early at a meeting, and you note with satisfaction that most people sitting at the table have their heads inclined, their eyes cast downward in contemplation, assuming the BlackBerry prayer position. You sit down quietly and join them in worship, in tune with the sound of little clicks. Later, the meeting becomes boring, and you feel a gentle buzz, which sounds kind of like a cross between a bee and a faraway cow. Without attracting notice, you remove the BlackBerry from your pocket, under the table, and sneak a quick peek at the screen. On Sunday, you're in church, and the sermon is wandering. You find it hard to concentrate, and only with great effort do you resist the urge to answer the buzz in your pocket. Or you take a winter break with your family, and you're sitting in a lounge chair on the beach. You tell your family you're reading an ebook, when in fact you're checking in with the office. You've been told that the project cannot go on without your input. Such is the life of the citizens of BlackBerry Planet. The addictive, immersive properties of smartphone use are now challenging the whole world of work, and we're a long way from being able to cope with the new power it gives us. In offices around the world, workers are drowning in email excess, and BlackBerry use is very much part of the problem. It's now clear that constant BlackBerry checking can actually nullify gains made in productivity, BlackBerry bondage can also make family life suffer, as employees bring their work home and never really leave the office behind. Any gains people make in organizing family messaging and scheduling can get cruelly offset by upsets in work-life balance. Says Canadian business professor Linda Duxbury, moderate users of the BlackBerry are okay, but for a growing number of people, the BlackBerry only contributes to stress and depression, and a decline in healthy personal and family life. How can managers and employees deal with this growing problem? In BlackBerry Planet, I explore the roots of device dependence and show how some people are handling it in creative and practical ways. I also suggest that we must come to terms with the power of mobile computing, and quickly, or risk suffering real social upheaval. The problem will certainly get worse before it gets better, as many more powerful features are being crammed into new releases of the BlackBerry and rival devices. In the next 20 years, we're going to have to learn how to cope with whole new generations of advanced superphones. These in turn will evolve even further into what I call the telebrain, a portable device more capable than the human brain itself, one that we can carry around in our pockets or even install under our skin, expanding our powers and connecting us directly with the whole intelligence of the planet. What of the future of research in motion? For a few weeks in 2007, REM became the largest company in Canada in terms of market cap. Today, battered by the global economic downturn but still driven by the need to compete, REM is fending off Apple and its superb iPhone while rapidly expanding its own reach across the planet, especially into the billion-fold market of India and China, where it is tackling the giant Finnish phone company Nokia head-on. In BlackBerry Planet, I have tried to probe the personal and corporate DNA that has driven research in motion and propelled the company over a 25-year period to become a global technology powerhouse. And one of the top three NASDAQ tech favorites, the other two being Apple and Google. BlackBerry Planet also explores the challenges of taking a dream to market and meeting the desire of customers all around the world to manage how they communicate to colleagues, clients, friends and loved ones in the easiest and most secure way possible. Above all, BlackBerry Planet is about the vision of Mike Lazaridis and his team of engineers, who were at the right place when it mattered and are still turning their vision of the future into reality.
1. The Planet Goes BlackBerry. When they go to work, people expect a phone, a desk, a chair, a light. And a BlackBerry has really taken on that status. Mike Lazaridis. Mike Lazaridis' little device is the favorite fruit of 25 million people across the planet who just can't get along without their innovative electronic organizer. But a scarce 10 years ago, the BlackBerry was known to only a few movers and shakers in Washington, on Wall Street, or in big high-tech firms like Intel and IBM. Back in 1999, Research in Motion, REM, built the first reliable product to offer two-way mobile email and messaging. At that time, pagers holstered on belts were part of the MD's or Wall Street broker's uniform, but they allowed only one-way communication. Lazaridis had realized that corporate technophiles wouldn't want to be tethered to their computers and would instead love to work anywhere, sending and receiving email directly on their pagers. So the BlackBerry easily won a favored spot on the belts of hard-charging political staffers and business professionals. From wireless warriors out in the field and battling for market share, to cubicle cowboys lunching at their desks, hunched over BlackBerries and juggling work and home. Today the BlackBerry monopolizes the world of work. Nobody else comes close. An astounding 85% of public corporations are supplying staff with the devices, and more than 175,000 BlackBerry Enterprise servers are installed worldwide. The U.S. Congress was REM's first big client, and Uncle Sam is still the biggest consumer of BlackBerries. Today, more than 500,000 devices are installed in every department of the U.S. government and throughout the U.S. Senate and House of Representatives. Some larger corporations are handling tens of thousands of email accounts securely and efficiently, and the top three or four companies each manage close to 100,000 BlackBerry users. Security is key. BlackBerry messages are secured with NATO-grade encryption, and network managers love the ability to freeze or wipe data from a lost or stolen BlackBerry. The BlackBerry is also super efficient. Studies show users can boost their productivity by 30%, and BlackBerry messaging is compressed, sometimes 20 times more than competing systems, so companies save a bundle in bandwidth costs. But REM has also adapted the BlackBerry to serve the consumer as well, and today more than 60% of users are outside the enterprise, buying their services from telecom providers. REM's original wireless devices were just glorified two-way pagers, used mainly by police, firefighters, and ambulance drivers. But that was a maturing market. When the company added enterprise servers with email, calendars, and contact lists to its first BlackBerries, REM started to get some real traction on Wall Street and inside the Washington Beltway. REM co-CEO Jim Balsillie was so confident that they had a winner on their hands, he seeded hundreds of those first BlackBerries to influential users. Soon, a growing number of leading executives, bankers, opinion makers, and politicians were adopting the addictive little devices. Unfortunately for REM, the BlackBerry was still unknown on Main Street, and growth sputtered. The big telecom providers weren't helping the picture. At the time, they were obsessed with selling their cell phone services, and wireless texting was a distinctly unsexy secondary market. It took a tragedy to get the BlackBerry to launch velocity, and it happened suddenly, on September 11, 2001. During the horrific attacks that day in New York and Washington, the only people trapped in the World Trade Center's Twin Towers who were able to contact their loved ones after cell phone service died were those with BlackBerries. Police, firefighters, and ambulance drivers, and U.S. Vice President Dick Cheney all used their BlackBerry devices during the crisis. According to a REM insider at the time, during 9/11, REM staff were pinning, messaging the hell out of the Mobitex and DataPack networks used by people with BlackBerries caught in the towers, while the support workers relied on them to communicate even while the regular cell lines were dead. The text network survived while the cell network died because it was barely used and signal strength was possible from remote nodes. Throughout the evacuation and collapse of the Twin Towers and during the surge in traffic, Singular kept its text-only Mobitex network running despite losing many base stations in Lower Manhattan. While slow at 12.5 kilobits per second, Mobitex on BlackBerries kept running while others failed, because it did not have to share precious bandwidth with voice. Also, even if an email got delayed because of network congestion, it was queued and sent just seconds later. After 9/11, more and more police and fire departments, as well as U.S. federal authorities, signed up for BlackBerry services. BlackBerries also shone during the great 2003 Northeast blackout and hurricanes Anita and Katrina. But it was in the U.S. Congress where the BlackBerry first gained a serious foothold. When all the politicians and their staffs were given the device, and all the lobbyists and people doing business in Washington followed, Capitol Hill became the first dedicated metropolis on BlackBerry Planet. REM's BlackBerry first came to the notice of congressional leaders during 9/11, when poor communications hampered the evacuation of the Capitol building. Washington was literally under attack for the first time since August 1814. It was only by luck that the third plane did not crash into the Capitol or White House. Michigan Representative Fred Upton, who already owned a BlackBerry, was one of the few people to get messages in and out during the chaos. RIM suddenly had a sterling reputation for security, and the U.S. Congress took notice. A few short weeks later, the October 2001 anthrax scare focused even more attention on BlackBerries, since Congress had to start sterilizing mail for biological hazards and screening it for bombs. This event delayed regular mail delivery to lawmakers by up to 2 weeks. Faced with these two crises, a rattled U.S. Congress promptly spent $6 million to buy BlackBerry Enterprise servers and 3,000 devices for all 100 senators, 435 House members, and thousands of staffers. There really were no other contenders, and Capitol Hill was soon hooked. Within a few years, Congress had more than 8,200 installed BlackBerries, and congressional servers were handling more than 25 million email messages a month. The BlackBerry quickly became a congressional essential. In 2006, Congress panicked and nearly declared a second American Revolution when Judge Spencer in Virginia, trying the NTP patent case against Research in Motion, threatened to shut down the BlackBerry service completely. Members of Congress rose unanimously against any threat to their constitutional right to bear BlackBerries. Today, BlackBerries have become so pervasive in American politics, the show probably could not run without them. New Jersey Representative Scott Garrett, recently interviewed by Politico, had this to say about his BlackBerry use. Garrett: "Yeah, today I was without it for about 45 minutes. And the whole time it was like panic." Politico: "I don't understand how members can outright not use one. It almost seems impossible." Garrett: "Well, obviously we did it before there were BlackBerries." The Age of Telepolitics. U.S. politics today is a fast-moving, lobby-driven profession, and the BlackBerry is a perfect prop and timely tool for lawmakers. In Washington, D.C., every congressional committee meeting is like an electronic trading pit, where competing vote traders watch the action intently, thumbing messages to and from their home offices. And behind every successful politician, you'll find an army of BlackBerry-toting telepoles, all plugged into their leader. Florida Representative Adam Putnam, who was part of the first freshman class to be issued a BlackBerry, says that member-to-member messaging is now pretty routine in the House. He says his party's leadership has started emailing key materials directly to members each morning, bypassing press people and staff. He feels the handhelds have broadened members' horizons by boosting their comfort level with the Internet. "So you have members talking about what's on Drudge or Town Hall or Red State. BlackBerries have dragged members out of the Dark Ages and into the information age. You now have members conversant about blogs, online news sites, signed up for breaking news alerts. So they're actually less insulated today than they were before BlackBerry." Karl Rove has more bandwidth, I think, than any presidential advisor has ever had in history. Mark McKinnon, Bush Media Consultant. The White House installed its first email services under George Bush Sr., but he personally never used them. Now, however, the elder Bush describes himself as a black belt wireless emailer. During Houston Astros games, he sits behind home plate with his BlackBerry and waves back on TV when he gets emails from friends. Bill Clinton was not a BlackBerry fan and sent only 2 emails during his entire term, preferring to use a secure cell phone and dedicated fax line. Even then, he felt increasingly isolated in the Oval Office, a place he liked to call the crown jewel of the federal penal system. According to Clinton aide Paul Begala, presidents can stay in touch with their pre-presidential friends, but they have to work at it. In the pre-BlackBerry age, presidents gave their friends their special, secret zip code, listed their names with the White House operator with instructions to put the calls through, even gave out the cell phone numbers of close aides. George W. Bush was expecting to be the first BlackBerry president, but he had to give his up on assuming office due to concerns about email security and the Presidential Records Act, PRA. The PRA puts each president's correspondence in the official record and ultimately up for public review or able to be subpoenaed by Congress or the courts. So, 3 days before Bush's first inauguration, knowing he was about to be locked into the Oval Office, he sent a mournful message from G94B at AOL.com to 42 friends and relatives that explained his predicament. "Since I do not want my private conversations looked at by those out to embarrass, the only course of action is not to correspond in cyberspace. This saddens me. I have enjoyed conversing with each of you." But for Bush's entourage, some of whom used their Republican National Committee BlackBerries and email accounts, it was business as usual. During the 2002 election season, Bush's friend and operative, Karl Rove, wore his war room on his belt. Rove's BlackBerry held his Rolodex and email system, which he used to flash marching orders to campaign workers and soothe worried lobbyists. Rove was such a BlackBerry devotee that Time magazine reported his device had every appearance of being surgically attached to his hand. Rove, aka the boy genius, amazed people with his BlackBerry use. "It's like haiku," said a friend. Even in the middle of meetings with Bush, Rove would spin the thumb wheel and punch out pithy messages with his big thumbs. "Sometimes we're in a meeting talking to each other," said a colleague, "and BlackBerrying each other at the same time." Unfortunately for Rove, his attempt to do an end run around the PRA by using Republican National Committee email accounts was slammed by a Washington judge, who called it an apparently flagrant violation of the Presidential Records Act. George W. Bush's lack of a BlackBerry may have insulated him more than he wanted to be. In Angler, Barton Gellman's book about the Cheney vice presidency, Cheney was facing a growing revolt by the Justice Department over warrantless wiretapping, and the acting attorney general finally came to see Bush and told the president he was refusing to go ahead. This crisis had been going on for 6 weeks, and nobody had been able to tell the president. Bush was completely shocked when he realized how insulated he had become. Says journalist Julian Sanchez, "Nobody wants to give the boss unwelcome news, and so the person at the top of the hierarchy often ends up least aware of what's going on. It's all too easy to imagine an online president getting bogged down in an unmanageable flood of correspondence, but there's also clear value in finding some way for folks at a few steps removed from the inner circle to circumvent the minders and get the attention of the president directly. Maybe it's time for dig.gov? Bush recalled that when he was governor of Texas, "I stayed in touch with all kinds of people around the country, firing off emails at all times of the day to stay in touch with my pals." When he returned to private life, says aide Karen Hughes, he immediately signed back on. Bush's brother, Florida Governor Jeb Bush, was also a BlackBerry addict and called himself America's first e-governor. He listed his email address publicly and personally answered hundreds of constituent emails a day. He feels his administration helped change how the government and people interrelate and helped make Floridians generally more hopeful and optimistic. In December 2006, Jeb Bush unveiled his official portrait at the governor's mansion in Tallahassee. It showed him standing beside a bookshelf with his personal BlackBerry next to a picture of his family. "In just the first few weeks, I've had to engage in some of the toughest diplomacy of my life. And that was just to keep my BlackBerry." Barack Obama. During the 2008 U.S. election campaign, Barack Obama campaign director David Axelrod got more and more frustrated when team attention wandered away during strategy meetings and participants went into BlackBerry prayer position. Even candidate Obama would sneak a peek at his device. So Axelrod came up with a brutal way of dealing with the problem. During work sessions, at the first sign of people getting into position, he ordered all participants, Obama included, to unholster their BlackBerries and place them in the center of the table. Obama was the first true BlackBerry candidate. During the campaign, aides did not send him printed stacks of briefing books, but rather emailed digests to his BlackBerry for review. He looked at longer documents on his laptop computer, putting his editorial changes in red type. He also relied on his BlackBerry to keep the home fires burning, emailing his wife and daughters constantly. And before bed, he played a few games of Brick Breaker to unwind. Reports say the president's high score is around 15,000. Right after Obama's election win, he replied to a friend's congratulatory email from his BlackBerry with the line, "How about that?" Ultimately, Obama had to face the same BlackBerry issues as George W. Bush. Even though he was elected in the most technologically sophisticated presidential campaign in history, the Secret Service told Obama he would have to give up his BlackBerry for security reasons once installed as chief executive. Hackers around the world would rise to the challenge of getting into the email of the most important smartphone on Earth. Look how easily amateur hackers got into Sarah Palin's personal email account, gov.palin@yahoo.com, during the election campaign. Also, every word a president generated by way of correspondence had to be archived. Finally, the White House was heavily protected by an electronic security field, and wireless didn't work too well inside. Imagine you're Barack Obama, said Michael Agger in Slate. Your operatives played social media like a fiddle when coordinating field operations via text message, email blast, and iPhone app. You proved yourself to be a modern info executive with your 3 a.m. emails and your preference for reviewing docs on your BlackBerry. Now you're preparing to enter the White House, and your BlackBerry is about to be ripped from your clutches. Said Obama advisor Linda Douglas, given how important it is for him to get unfiltered information from as many sources as possible, I can imagine he will miss that freedom. Campaign manager David Plouffe said that losing his BlackBerry would be more than just an inconvenience for Obama. It's an important way for him to operate with his colleagues, but also it's very important for him to stay in touch with his friends and his family. It's something he's really struggling with. He does live his life through technology. Barack Obama had the guts to quit smoking during the election campaign. Now the most powerful man on the planet was told he was going to have to go cold turkey on his BarackBerry as well. No doubt his wife Michelle had mixed feelings. An amateur video clip taken in Chicago showed her slapping her husband's hand when he took his BlackBerry from his holster to check his email during his daughter's soccer game. He quickly put it back. Later in the game, the clip showed him patting his holster absent-mindedly but not daring to pull out the device. Obama was well aware he would have a harder time kicking his BlackBerry addiction, and in a post-election interview with Barbara Walters, he said that he was trying to find a way to keep both his BlackBerry and personal email account. One of the things that I'm going to have to work through is how to break through the isolation, the bubble that exists around the president. And I'm in the process of negotiating with the Secret Service, with lawyers, with White House staff, to figure out how I can get information from outside of the 10 or 12 people who surround my office in the White House. because one of the worst things I think that can happen to a president is losing touch with the struggles that people are going through every day. Some commentators felt that breaking his BlackBerry habit would be a good thing for Obama. Would the United States have wanted a BlackBerry president anyway, and a self-confessed CrackBerry addict to boot? Some studies show that BlackBerry-wielding multitaskers end up performing each task a bit more poorly since they are afflicted by continuous partial attention. Better a president who can concentrate on one crisis at a time. But Obama continued to resist, even after his inauguration, and senior advisor David Axelrod told ABC News he's pretty determined. In a New York Times interview, Obama told John Harwood, "I'm still clinging to my BlackBerry. They're going to pry it out of my hands." Harwood, "Well, are you in fact going to overcome this idea as anachronistic that presidents can't use the most modern?" President-elect Obama, "Well, here's what I think I can get. I think I'm going to be able to get access to a computer somewhere. It may not be right in the Oval Office. The second thing I'm hoping to do is to see if there's some way that we can arrange for me to continue to have access to a BlackBerry. I know that." Harwood, "As of this moment, you still have your BlackBerry." President-elect Obama, "As of this moment, I still do. This is a concern, I should add, not just of Secret Service, but also lawyers. You know, this town's full of lawyers. I don't know if you've noticed." Harwood, "Yeah." President-elect Obama, "And they have a lot of opinions, and so I'm still in a scuffle around that, but it... Look, it's the hardest thing about being president." President-elect Obama, "I don't know that I'll win, but I'm still fighting it. But here's the point I was making, I guess, is that it's not just flow of information. I mean, I can get somebody to print out clips for me, and I can read newspapers. But what it has to do with is having mechanisms where you are interacting with people who are outside of the White House in a meaningful way. And I've got to look for every opportunity to do that. Ways that aren't scripted. Ways that aren't controlled. Ways where, you know, people aren't just complimenting you or standing up when you enter into a room. Ways of staying grounded. And if I can manage that over the next 4 years, I think that will help me serve the American people better because I'm going to be hearing their voices. They're not going to be muffled as a consequence of me being in the White House." In a third interview with John King on CNN, Obama was a little more belligerent about hanging on to his BlackBerry. "I think we're going to be able to beat this back," he said. "I think we're going to be able to hang on to one of these." Obama said he would be more careful about how he used the device. "Now, my working assumption, and this is not new, is that everything I write on email could end up being on CNN, so I make sure that to think before I press send." Describing his BlackBerry as just one tool among a number of tools that I'm trying to use to break out of the bubble, the yet-to-be-inaugurated Democrat said he wanted to make sure that people can still reach me, but if I'm doing something stupid, somebody in Chicago can send me an email and say, "What are you doing?" You know, or, "You're too detached," or, "You're not listening to what is going on here in the neighborhood." I want to be able to have voices, other than the people who are immediately working for me, be able to reach out and send me a message about what's happening in America. Priceless publicity. All this will-he-or-won't-he commentary about Barack Obama's BlackBerry was a godsend for him. Doug Shabelman is president of Burns Entertainment, which arranges deals between celebrities and companies. He estimates the worldwide publicity value of the president's struggles to keep his beloved Verizon BlackBerry 8830 World Edition Curve on assuming office at about $50 million. He's consistently seen using it, and consistently in the news arguing, and arguing with issues of national security and global welfare. how he absolutely needs this to function on a daily basis. Think about how far the company has come if they're able to say, the president has to have this to keep in touch. Laura Rees, president of marketing strategy firm Rees & Rees, and co-author of 4 books on brands and marketing, pegs the publicity value to REM at more than $100 million a year if Obama were able to make product endorsements. That would top the marketing take of Tiger Woods, she said. How often does a president get photographed? Every 5 minutes. The potential of him being in a photo using a BlackBerry in all likelihood is incredibly high. That would be very powerful. A big chunk of the public sympathized with Obama's problem. In a San Francisco Chronicle poll, 50% of respondents said no when asked whether Obama should have to give up his BlackBerry, and 24% argued he should keep it to create a record of his presidential doings. A further 18% said he'll be too busy with other matters to bother with checking his email. Lori Sale, head of artist marketing at the Paradigm Talent Agency, says that the fact Barack Obama was not paid to promote his BlackBerry is even better for Research in Motion. What makes it even more valuable than that is how authentic it is, she said. Fran Kelly, CEO of ad agency Arnold Worldwide, said that Obama's tacit endorsement worked both ways. While he did a lot for the BlackBerry brand, the smartphone boosted Obama's image in turn. The BlackBerry anecdotes are a huge part of Mr. Obama's brand reputation, he said. It positions him as one of us. He's got friends and family and people to communicate with, just like all of us. And it positions him as a next-generation politician. John McCain suffered in comparison when he confessed to reporters that he didn't know how to check email and relied on his wife for computing. On the other hand, his running mate, Alaska Governor Sarah Palin, governs by BlackBerry. She has 2 devices and confesses she feels naked without her BlackBerries. President Barack Hussein Obama has changed everything about America already, not just by being what he is, but by being who he is. He is not just the first black president. He is the first BlackBerry president. Tina Brown. Even after the inauguration, Obama transition co-chair John Podesta kept up the spin, putting Obama's need to connect on a higher plane. Obama's politics are interactive, solutions-oriented, and open to the citizens, he said. Obama's BlackBerry enhanced his decision-making by helping him reach outside his inner circle. Let the man have his BlackBerry, Podesta declared. An offline Obama isn't just bad for Barack. It's bad for all of us. Others argued that the 1978 Presidential Records Act was obsolete in light of 30 years of information technology, IT, advancement. Congress needed to hold hearings to update the law rather than puzzle over whether it applied to email and messaging. Still others suggested that President Obama use other National Security Agency-approved smartphones, such as General Dynamics Sectera Edge, or the new Guardian from L3 Communications. But there's a learning curve with switching to a new operating system. Some said that the phone was the major security problem. The Secret Service and National Security Agency saw that the main danger to the president lay with the cellular radio in the device, which constantly syncs with nearby wireless networks so calls can be routed to the phone. If bad guys ever got access to the cell phone systems that handled Obama's BlackBerry, they might be able to ping his smartphone to a wireless tower and track his movements. Or they could scan cellular frequencies over several days to triangulate his exact position, even down to one of several identical limousines, even though they could not decode the AES-128 encrypted BlackBerry data. So, maybe REM could supply the president with a more secure pen device only? Obama's BlackBerry battle was priceless PR for REM in the short run, but Roger Entner, an analyst with market researcher Nielsen Company in Boston, said the device would be a magnet for spies and a significant share of Russia's signal intelligence and China's signal intelligence and cyber intelligence budgets would be targeted to break it. This would put REM's sterling reputation at risk. Security expert Bruce Schneier said about Obama, "Look, he can decide to paint the White House blue if he wants. The internet is the greatest generation gap since rock and roll. The NSA will tell you the risks, but they will never say here's what the benefits are. Obama might be productive and effective with a BlackBerry, but the risk of hacking the presidential BlackBerry is high, and in any event, it is not possible to have absolute certainty that email actually came from Obama. No encryption program solves that," he said. Gartner security analyst John Pescatore said the problem was switching to unclassified mode to use the regular internet. "Internet email is totally unacceptable for a president to use," Pescatore said. "There is no strong authentication. How can anyone prove an email came from the president? There is no integrity. How can anyone prove the content wasn't changed? And use of encryption doesn't stop anyone from forwarding an email from him outside that closed loop." Obama advisor John Podesta urged him to find a workaround to satisfy the security team. "They'd keep you in a lead container in the basement if you let them." In the end, presidential security could not trump Barack Obama's CrackBerry addiction, and he didn't have to kick his tech habit, at least not entirely. He won the battle to keep his beloved BlackBerry, albeit a crippled custom version without a phone, for personal use only, that connected through a secure base station. His address would change regularly, and friends could not forward his emails or send him attachments. The National Security Agency also limited his address list to an elite group of West Wing staffers, family, and friends, who were all given security briefings. He and his wife Michelle insisted on family contact. Vice President Joe Biden has access to Obama, as do White House Chief of Staff Rahm Emanuel, advisors David Axelrod and Valerie Jarrett, and Press Secretary Robert Gibbs. It is not known whether Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, talk show diva Oprah Winfrey, or actor Scarlett Johansson have the president's ear or thumb. For any phone calls in the wild, President Obama first had to use the clunky but powerful $3,350 Sectera Edge made under special contract by General Dynamics, which has dedicated channels not on the public cell networks. In June 2009, he took delivery of a custom BlackBerry 8830 running special secure voice encryption software developed by Washington, D.C. tech firm The Genesis Key in concert with REM. The software scrambles phone calls, emails, and text messages to the highest possible level required by the NSA, but it can be used only to hook up with other BlackBerries running the same encryption software. And the president may have to wait up to 50 minutes for an email reply, since the system actively sniffs out incoming messages from viruses or Trojan horses. The Presidential Records Act says anything President Obama emails, IMs, and pens will have historic value and must be saved. But historians will have to wait as long as 20 years to read them. While Washington learned to cope, similar BlackBerry tensions also arose in other Democratic assemblies around the world. Canada, home base of the BlackBerry, was not immune. In May 2004, the Speaker of the Ontario Legislature in Toronto, Alvin Curling, told the members that the use of BlackBerries had gotten out of hand, especially since the electronic devices are prohibited. Curling declared a war on CrackBerries when he saw a minister reading a statement off her BlackBerry. Ottawa, Ontario, Canada is a political town, chock full of BlackBerry addicts. Overall, the city shares with Washington, D.C., a kind of frantic machismo about using the device. Prime Minister Stephen Harper does not use a BlackBerry, but his staffers and most other politicians on Parliament Hill are dependent. All members of Parliament, MPs, and their staffs are given 4 BlackBerries by the office of the Speaker of the House. Former Liberal MP and financial author Garth Turner is a self-confessed connection junkie who sleeps with his BlackBerry next to his bed. Turner particularly hates long flights when his precious device no longer works. Traveling is hard enough, he says, but traveling without your BlackBerry vibrating reassuringly on your hip is absolute digital hell. Durham MP Mark Holland says he felt phantom vibrations when away from his device for 3 days, and notes that there is a BlackBerry-driven sub-conversation going on all the time in committee and in the House. There is also an emergent BlackBerry etiquette where it's okay to use the device, even at a dinner, when everybody else is also tapping away, but it's important to be aware if there are any non-addicts in the room who might be insulted. But there are islands of sanity on Parliament Hill. All parties ask their MPs to check their BlackBerries at the door of caucus meetings, and the Liberal Party caucus even went so far as to pass a rule banning them outright. You can also find a few people off the Hill with some decent perspective on Rim's invention and how it ought to be used. Dick Fadden is former Deputy Minister of Citizenship and Immigration in the Government of Canada. Fadden became a hero to his department and to scores of government employees when in January 2008, he banned BlackBerry use for business from 7 o'clock at night and on weekends. Well, not exactly banned. Fadden called the new policy operating rules designed to help attack some of the stresses around work. BlackBerry blackout between the hours of 7 p.m. and 7 a.m., and on weekends and holidays. Meetings should not be held during the lunch hour. BlackBerries should not be used during meetings. Meetings should start and finish on time as a means of managing workloads. I visited Fadden a year after the famous memo and asked him whether the policy had any effect. Right away he said, "Look, we consider the BlackBerry has great value in the department. It's a useful tool and boosts productivity, but it has to be managed." I asked him whether he had done any analysis of the BlackBerry blackout. He said he brought it up regularly with his managers and found the main result was a major drop in the amount of email delivered in the department, although it is creeping up again. How did Fadden manage his own personal use as a senior public servant? He said he never uses email on his BlackBerry, but only pens or sends messages for security. Email stays on his PC. He turns his off at 11 at night, but of course he still has to be available for emergencies by phone 24/7. Fadden says public reaction to his policy was mixed. Some newspaper letter writers said he should get a life, or join the 21st century. One senior manager sniffed that the BlackBerry blackout was a stupid decision that pretends to deal with the real issue of workload and stress. So would we have banned telephones on bureaucrats' desks at the turn of the century? But overall, the policy struck a nerve. People in Fadden's department were clearly suffering under the onslaught of email and the expectation of always being on. They knew they needed to manage their addiction and attack their BlackBerry abuse. One employee told CTV News, "We're feeling the pressure trying to get a lot of stuff done in a short period of time, and the fact that they're recognizing our families are suffering the consequences of it. I think it's a good idea." I asked Fadden why these kinds of operating rules were not more popular and why they weren't government policy across the board. He said other departments were bringing in similar guidelines to a greater or lesser extent, but that it was not something that should be imposed from above. Policies had to be tailored to each department, and managers had to be convinced they were useful in their particular cases. Fadden acknowledged his measures might seem a bit artificial to some. Obviously, you had to be flexible and recognize that some meetings had to go on longer, or you had to keep your BlackBerry on at critical times. But finding ways to respect the needs of employees to balance their work and life was worth it. And the very fact of having a policy, not a ban, still makes people aware of the dangers and time-wasting if they don't respect others in the amount of email they send. Linda Duxbury, a professor at Carleton University's Sprott School of Business in Ottawa, hailed Fadden's move as visionary, since, in her opinion, many people in the public service were too wired to do their jobs efficiently and productively. Good for him. It's the kind of leadership the public service needs. And this is leadership because he's doing something that is not easy. The whole public service revolves around the BlackBerry and being available 24/7, and he's the first to go beyond talking about balance. Queen Elizabeth II is a thoroughly modern, high-tech monarch. She gets a buzz from her royal BlackBerry, a gift from Vodafone. She is, by all accounts, only moderately addicted and gives trusted reporters a business card with her email address. Apparently, it's not oneself at houseofwindsor.uk. The Queen got her first mobile phone in 2001, but never uses it in public. She also banned her staff from using them while on duty at Buckingham Palace, Balmoral, Sandringham, and Windsor Castle. Several waiters and butlers were nearly sent off for beheading when they were caught fumbling with their ringing phones during an official banquet for a foreign dignitary. As befitting her regal status, the Queen normally dictates replies to an aide rather than writing them herself. However, Buckhouse insiders say she does use her handheld to send short messages to Princes William and Harry, who taught her how to text. The 83-year-old Queen was turned on to BlackBerries in 2005 by her son Prince Andrew, the Duke of York, who equipped himself and his staff with the devices. Her Majesty already owned an Apple iPod, which she filled with patriotic tunes such as Land of Hope and Glory, and other favorites from The Last Night of the Proms. In 2007, she delivered her Christmas Day message for the first time as an MP3 podcast. The palace, like any other well-run business, is now properly equipped with a secure BES and BlackBerries to enable members of the royal family and their staff to keep in discreet but constant touch with their offices while out and about on official engagements. The Duke of York himself is a technology fanatic and regularly attends conferences. He is enthusiastic about BlackBerry innovations, and in 2008, he joined Mike Lazaridis to officially open the new UK headquarters of Research in Motion in Slough, England. Apparently, by appointment to Her Majesty the Queen, still rules the waves. Electromagnetic ones. Across the Channel in France, it was another story. President Nicolas Sarkozy clearly had a problem with his BlackBerry manners. By 2007, he was becoming known as the King of Bling for his serious attachment to clunky watches, Ray-Ban aviators, and obsessive BlackBerry use. The French were shocked when he risked offending Pope Benedict by sneaking a peek at his BlackBerry during an audience with the pontiff. Presumably, it was an urgent call from his gorgeous new lady, now his wife, Italian model and singer Carla Bruni. By early 2008, Sarkozy's popularity ratings had plummeted, and he was forced by his advisors to adjust his lifestyle before a state visit to England to visit Queen Elizabeth. With this excursion, the rebranded and re-presidentialized Sarkozy soon redeemed himself in the eyes of the French. He and Madame Bruni appeared in understated yet elegant couture befitting a head of state and consort. The notoriously impatient president's BlackBerry was nowhere to be seen, and his ratings recovered as he re-emerged as a leader of elegance and discretion. According to the emerging etiquette of the online era, It's the height of rudeness to take out your handheld device and check your emails while friends or colleagues are talking. But what if they've been talking for 7 hours? Oliver Berkman, The Guardian. Downsides to BlackBerry politics are emerging. For one thing, BlackBerries are now the new techno-crypt sheet, allowing handlers to provide real-time feedback to their politicians. In the 2004 U.S. election, Senate Democratic candidate Representative Peter Deutsch was caught checking his device during a live TV debate in Florida. He said he was getting words of encouragement from his staff and only checked it during commercials. WPTV producer Tom Costinotis said he will consider asking candidates not to wear or hold BlackBerries during debates in the future. Another downside to BlackBerry use can be obsession with the device over the job. During the 2008 Democratic leadership campaign, it emerged that Hillary Clinton's staffers were spending more time relating to the media and interfacing with star reporters than promoting the fortunes of their candidate. New York Democratic National Committee member Robert Zimmerman, a prominent Clinton supporter, publicly grumbled that Hillary Clinton has a very powerful populist message about issues that impact people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.